Let me just get my slides open and start off. So today I've been asked to speak on, Dr. Raghu said, the relationship between what's going on inside in gut metabolic syndrome. Now, when I was asked to speak on this, I actually had to read up multiple papers because this is not work that I have done. And I hadn't spoken on this. So if there are questions that I leave open, that are open at the end, I would have to get back to you on that because there's still a lot of things going on in the field research-wise and a lot of things are still inconclusive at this point of time. Having said that, the papers were also quite long and quite boring to read. So I've tried to make this very simple, easy to follow with a lot of colors and cartoons here. So let's start off now and first ask the question, how does the food we eat affect our health? And if you think of it broadly like this, you know, on the left, you eat a lot of high calorie food, junk food, and this is linked to obesity, metabolic syndrome. So we know this. And on the right of your screen, you eat healthy, sort of green leafy vegetables, low calorie diet. You make sure your BMI is within the Asian cutoff and also look at waist-hip ratio and all that is okay. And you're green, so you're actually healthier and the chances of having high cholesterol or dyslipidemia or metabolic syndrome, hypertension, diabetes, all of that is lesser. But the thing is, it's not really that simple because if you start going into the world of microbes, there are more than 1,000 species of bacteria hidden inside our GI tract. Some of these bugs are good bugs and some of these bugs are bad bugs. So let's start by first accepting that, okay, there is research going on here. And what does the research tell us? That the food we eat, it alters this bacterial world which is inside us. So the healthy food increase the good bugs and the unhealthy food increase the bad bugs. Let's start keeping that in mind. Now, what happens if the good bugs or the bad bugs actually increase in number? So that's the next question. Now, irrespective of what kind of microbiota we all have inside us, these microbiota produce different metabolites. Now, when they produce good metabolites or metabolites that are good for our health, we call them good bugs. So we have a healthy gut. On the other hand, if the bacteria are producing metabolites which have a negative impact on our health, on the host health, we call them bad bugs. This is an unhealthy gut. Now let's learn some of the names of the good and bad bacteria. There are many more in this list also because every paper has like three or four additional names. I've just put in a few here. And maybe at the end, the audience who can remember the names, we can send them a chocolate or a prize. Okay, so the symbionts are the good bugs. So this is Lactobacillus. So that's easy. That's easy to remember. Bifidobacteria and Bacteroidetes species. Then on the other hand, the red are the pathogenic, like the Clostridium group and the Firmicutes group. And this list actually goes on. Now, where did we start? What did we learn when we started looking at gut of different metabolic syndrome and without metabolic syndrome? When people started to study this, they realized that those with metabolic syndrome had different gut microbiome profiles. What we've seen in them is these pathogenic or harmful bacteria, they were much more, and the green or the symbionts were much lesser. Whereas those with individuals without metabolic syndrome, they had more of these healthy bacteria and more diverse species of bacteria and very less of the pathogenic bacteria. So what happens? What do the good ones do? And what do the bad ones actually do to us? Now the good or the healthy microbiota, they're anti-inflammatory, they're antioxidant, they regulate the gut barrier and local immune response, they reduce endotoxemia, and improve insulin sensitivity. On the other hand, the dysbiotic gut or the unhealthy gut bacteria, increase the pro-inflammatory cytokines, increase gut permeability, so there's more leak there, so this local immune response is inhibited, increases lipopolysaccharide, just reduces insulin sensitivity. It also apparently makes people more hungry, so actually makes them eat more, and this directly contributes to adiposity. So in addition to this, people with a healthy gut have a more diverse microbiota with a higher number of bacterial gene count, whereas those with an unhealthy or a dysbiotic gut have a much lower bacterial gene count. Now, it has been seen and studied that by eating unhealthy food, high fat, high sugar, a lot of antibiotics and stress, these sort of things can actually change the way our gut behaves. So we could move from a healthy gut microbiota to a dysbiotic gut. On the other hand, eating a healthy diet, losing weight, taking prebiotics, probiotics, though we don't have any dose or anything like that for any of this at this point. And even studies with fecal transplantation of healthy gut has shown that we could move from a dysbiotic gut to an improved gut health or healthy microbiota. And what are the disorders linked with a dysbiotic gut? Metabolic diseases, cardiovascular diseases, and inflammatory bowel disease. In addition, it has also been seen that in individuals with a symbiotic gut, the bacteria produce more of butyrate, and whereas in people with metabolic syndrome and who are overweight or obese, this loss is seen. So what else happens in a dysbiotic gut? These bad bacteria, they supposedly increase the short chain fatty acids, increase lipogenesis. In addition, they also directly cause an increase in appetite. So we don't, we sometimes think, okay, you're not controlling your hunger, and we tell someone you need to work harder on your desires, but it might actually be the gut bacteria having a relationship there with an individual's appetite. So this increase in appetite actually increases the energy absorption. And this happens because there's a direct increase in monosaccharide absorption and increase in SGLT1 expression in these individuals. So people with poor gut health are potentially at a risk of developing a number of problems. And the disorders linked to poor gut health, obesity, hypoglycemia, dyslipidemia, hypertension, NAFLD, inflammatory bowel disease also I mentioned earlier, and gut barrier is affected, so there's more of inflammation happening there. So what is the evidence to support all the things I've said? So there is some evidence from animal studies and human studies, so let's look at that. Now in animal studies, I haven't listed all the studies, these are a couple of examples. Now they took mice, they made these mice eat a very high fat diet. What they found was when they gave a high-fat diet to mice, there was an increase in gram-negative bacteria, lipopolysaccharides, endotoxemia. This resulted in weight gain, increased insulin resistance. So hyperinsulinemia was a consequence of that, and this resulted finally in hyperglycemia. In another study, what they did was they transplanted the gut from obese mice, what you see here, in my arrow here, called conventionally raised mice, or the red. So these are obese mice. So they took the gut microbiota from the obese mice into the genetically thin mice, which is called the germ-free mice, which has less body fat. And what they observed was when they took the unhealthy gut and put it into the thin mice actually grew much fatter. So there was a 60% increase in body fat, triglyceride, insulin resistance. And this was independent of food intake. So these mice were not given a high-fat diet. They were just given unhealthy gut microbiome from the obese mice. And they started to exhibit all the characteristics of the obese mice. What about human studies? Now, there are some studies which have gone on in humans as well, with fecal microbiota transplantation. Now, in this particular study here, a small study that was done, they took individuals with metabolic syndrome and put them into two groups. One group was given gut microbiota from thin, healthy males, And the other group, which is the control group, got a transplant of microbiota from their own gut. So different things were measured at baseline and follow-up, like insulin resistance, sensitivity, what microbiomes lived in these people, and so on. So what was seen was that those who got the healthy microbiota transplant, they had more diversity in their microbiota, reduced insulin resistance, increased insulin sensitivity, and increase in butyrate-producing bacteria. Whereas those who were their own controls basically had less diversity of microbiota, more insulin resistance, less insulin sensitivity. In addition to this, it's also been seen that in humans, there's an alteration of the good and bad bacteria ratio. So bacteroidetes is good, firmicutes is bad, and this can sometimes also cause all these different changes. So they've also studied this in a couple of studies. Now, as I mentioned, normally someone who has a healthy gut should have more of bacteroidetes, which is good for us. Therefore, I put it in green, and less of firmicutes, which is bad for us, which is why it's in red. But what happens in metabolic syndrome or obesity is that this ratio actually gets altered. So there's more of the bad bacteria and less of the good bacteria. So when these obese individuals are put on a weight-reducing diet, low-calorie diet, not for 1 month or 2 months, but actually a whole year, they lose weight. And then their microbiota is studied. It was found that the bad bacteria actually reduce and the good bacteria actually increase. So there's an increase in bacteroidetes and reduction in firmicutes. When the energy absorption is also measured, it is found that increase in firmicutes, which is bad, remember, causes an increase in nutrient absorption, and an increase in bacteroidetes, which is the good green stuff here, actually causes a decrease in nutrient absorption. So it's not just how much we eat or what we eat. If our bacteria changes independent of the food intake, our energy absorption or nutrient absorption can vary. So what are the future directions here? Maybe with more time and understanding, we'd know if we can actually have more therapeutic options in terms of probiotic, prebiotic dosing to improve our gut health, which could be an addition to various different medications we have for management of diabetes. So this might be another arm that could potentially come in someday in the future. Fecal transplantation is being studied for different diseases. It's not a therapeutic option yet, but we really don't know what the future will hold. So let us wait and see. So to conclude and sum up, the gut microbiota, we know now and we acknowledge that it plays an important role in maintaining our health. We know the main differences is that individuals with metabolic syndrome, they have reduced microbial diversity. They have less of the good bacteria and more of the bad bacteria. We've seen from animal experiments and small human studies that a high-fat diet pushes us towards an unhealthy gut, and changing our gut microbiota also makes us develop obesity. Also, that weight loss, having a low-calorie diet, can reverse these dysbiotic changes that have gone on inside. So hopefully we'll learn more with time, and I hope I could make this quite simple for all of you listening. So thank you very much.